This is Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Welcome to the weekly top three, the top three things on our mind here at Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets for the week of May 25th, 2020. The weekly top three is a regular segment on the Michael Duke Show. The show broadcasts on Facebook Live and via streaming audio from the show's website weekdays from 6 to 8 a.m. I join Michael weekly in the first hour of Tuesday's show from 6:20 to 7 a.m. for a discussion between the two of us about our three issues. We post the podcasts of our discussion following the show on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook, YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify pages, also on the new Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets website, as well as the projects page on national blog site medium.com. You can find past episodes of the weekly top three also at the same locations. Keep in mind that in addition to these podcasts, during the week, you also can follow and participate in the discussion with us of these and other issues affecting Alaska's fiscal and economic condition by following us on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook page and through our posts on Twitter. This week, our top three issues are these. First, what will we be focused on with candidates as we head into the election season? Second, where is the LNG project headed now that it has FERC approvals? And third, why Alyeska's recent announcement that it is ending curtailments doesn't mean TAPS is back up and running at bigger volumes. And now, let's join Michael.
Let's get into this and talk about the weekly top three. And I just discussed it a few minutes ago because you can see it in my schedule. But we're going to be focusing in on elections. And that's really kind of the big news where we go from here now that the legislature is has adjourned and sin died out. I mean, where do we go now?
Yeah. So the same thing I was focusing on over the weekend is that filing date for candidates, for primary candidates, and for general election independents is a week from today.
Right.
June 1st.
Yep.
And we're off to the races with people. Alaska is always is interesting to me because there's always some surprises at the end in the filings and in candidates. And I'm interested to see who pops up at the end of this filing cycle.
Yeah, you always get that. You always get that notice in the paper the next day that at the last minute, at 3:49 p.m., somebody waltzed in with their $35 or whatever it is to file, and you're like, "Wow, didn't see that coming." Not at all.
And we've got some candidates out there that need, or we got some incumbents that need opposition, and hopefully there's some people considering running against them and setting up some primary challenges, or long game, setting up an independent run against the candidate.
Right.
But the thing that I also focused on as I was thinking about it is what's going to be, at least for us, what's going to be the defining issue during this primary season. And certainly it's going to be the budget. There's going to be a lot of talk about oil as well with the oil tax initiative on the ballot. But certainly to us, it's going to be the budget. But it's not just next year's budget. I mean, the thing that I want to keep coming back to, the thing that I want that I think it's important to focus on, is we're not facing a one-year crisis. We're not even facing a two-year crisis. We're facing a crisis that now goes on for the next decade, at least, if not beyond that. When you look at traditional revenues and you look at oil prices, I mean, oil prices have recovered from their sub-zero period, but they're steadying in the $30 range, which is substantially below where we thought we were going to be a year ago. And the outlook is that they continue in that $30, $40, $50 range over the next decade. And then you look at the spending levels that we've had, even if you cap spending at inflation, they're just well in excess of billions of dollars in excess of additional revenue levels. So what we're going to be looking for with candidates, how are we going to address that gap? Certainly the Part of it is the Hammond 50-50 approach, but that still leaves a billion plus averaged over the next decade, about $1.6 billion a fiscal gap. So how are you going to close that fiscal gap? And again, it's not, we're just not asking the question for next year, because, you know, some people would say, well, we're not going to do the reverse sweep, and so we'll have, you know, the PCE to pay for it. It's not just a next year issue. It's a decade long issue.
Right.
And we're going to be looking for candidates who talk about how they're structurally going to fix this issue, not just, you know, raid the last piggy bank they can find to patch it over
right.
for another year.
Well, Brad Keithley is our guest, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. You put together a good chart which takes a look at those revenue forecasts going out for the next 10 years. And it's not, I mean, it's colorful, but it's not pretty. I guess we'll put it that way. I mean, we're looking at some serious deficits, and we need some new solutions, you know, but we can't do business as usual.
Yeah, for those looking at it on Facebook, the blue is the projection of traditional revenues, and this is at, you know, $30 growing to $40 and $50, $40 oil over the 10-year period. That's what we get out of traditional revenues, about $1.5 billion averaged over the next decade. The yellow is the 50-50 split. It is the 50% that goes to government using POMV 50-50, the 50% that goes to government, and that's about $1.6 billion. So between the two, you've got about $3 billion, a little over $3 billion in revenues that you're looking at. But the spending side, I know a lot of people talk about, well, I'm going to cap spending and inflation. Okay, well, this caps spending and inflation. And the spending side over the next decade averages out at about $5 billion, about $4.9 billion. So you've got about $3 billion in revenues. You got about $4.9 billion, a little over $3 billion in revenues. You got about $4.9 billion in spending. And that's a gap of about $1.6 billion, $1.7 billion, somewhere in that neighborhood. And that is every year, year in, year out. And as we talked on last week's show, even if you undid the reverse sweep, even if you took PCE and all that stuff, that gives you maybe $1.5 billion, maybe gives you 1 year's worth of revenues. So the structural issues that we're facing, the gap is in the gray in that chart. The structural issues that we're facing are just long lasting, and you know, some people are going to answer it by saying, well, I'm just going to cut spending. Well, you got to cut spending immediately, because we're not going to phase into this situation. We're deep into it now. It starts, it started, you know, several years ago, and it continues on. And we've used up savings. We've used up the statutory budget reserve and the constitutional budget reserve, about $20 billion in savings. And so, you know, we're into it right now. So if you're going to cut, you got to cut now. If that's your solution, you got to cut now, and you've got to cut deep. And so the question is going to be, where are you going to cut? Remember that Governor Dunleavy tried to cut $1 billion a couple of years ago, and we saw the outrage over that. And that was just $1 billion, and this is $1 billion plus over the course of 10 years.
Right.
So the structural, focusing on the structural fix, and having candidates talk about how they're going to address that that structural issue long term, I think is the key to the key issue that we're going to be focusing on in the coming election cycle.
We also, of course, on the program here, we have our charter of changes, and I don't think you and I have really, we've discussed it in passing, but I think those four components as well are going to be very important. The changing of the players, obviously, is what you're working on now. Changing the venue up until, you know, moving the legislative session on the road system, also important. But those three rules, the changing of the rules, the binding caucus, the conflict of interest rules, and the Open Meetings Act, I think all of those will be critical as well. What do you think?
Yeah, that's sort of the process. I mean, you got to have a process to get to structural change, right? And you've got to have an open and transparent process, and a process that creates incentives for people to make these fundamental changes. And I think those process issues are critical as well. But what are you trying to achieve at the end of the day with the process changes? And it's you're trying to achieve the substantive change of getting the budget back under control, and getting the fiscal future that we're facing resolved. And so it's sort of a combination of both. You need the process to work toward. You need a good solid process that works toward a solution, and then you need. But you also need to have the solution in mind. What you're working toward.
As you look at this and the slate of candidates, and of course, all 40 representatives and 11 of the 20 senators are up for re-election, are you going to be focusing on some specific races, do you think, as you dive down into this and take a look at it? Are there folks out there that you believe, are linchpins in this whole system that kind of need to go, that they're, the ringleaders, as it were, of, the symphony of our own destruction here, that just need to be ousted?
I do. I mean, there's leadership in the legislature that I think has led us into this problem, have temporized, and have come up with the wrong solutions. Natasha von Imhoff is certainly one of those. Kathy Geisel is one of those. John Coghill is one of those over in the House. Gary Knopp was a key player, I think, in setting the legislature off on the wrong path. And Ron Gillum, I think, is certainly a strong challenger, as he showed last election cycle in his run against Peter Machecki. I think Ron's a strong challenger. There on the House side, I hope we find somebody that strong. I don't know. There's two opponents already signed on to run against Jennifer Johnston. And I think that's a good thing. I think Chuck Kopp is another problem in the House. Somebody who's viewed the PFD as a piggy bank to be raided and used to continue to fund government rather than using more equitable means. So yes, it's really leadership, changing the leadership, maybe bringing new people into leadership. In the caucus vote, but changing out the leadership, I think, is where our focus is going to be.
Harold says the major factor utilized by the leadership resulting in the crashing of the state is the binding caucus. And that's kind of what we were talking about earlier. They've held a lot of people's feet to the fire, and they've been allowed to kind of steer the ship with that, Brad. It has been the one major tool that is basically, I mean, even people who I thought were, good people, Tammy Wilson, et cetera, who fought very hard during the process to try and shrink the government and shrink the budgets. Even they were, kind of bullied into it in the end, voting for budgets that they didn't agree with because of this binding caucus idea.
Yeah, I've had problems with the binding caucus going back to 2014. I had a big falling out at one point with one of the state representatives over that very issue. She was continuing to advocate for the binding caucus in the 2014 election. I went a different direction, and she got really upset. So I think the binding caucus has been a problem for a long time. But yes, that the process is a problem. But you have to move beyond that. And what I'm concerned about this election cycle, frankly, is candidates who are going to try to get by on things like, capping spending at inflation and preserving the PFD and all good issues, but they leave that billion and a half dollar gap between preserving the PFD, taking traditional revenues where they are, and capping spending at inflation. We have to do more, much more, to reset our fiscal picture. And so this is not going to be an election cycle where, to me, it's going to be satisfactory just to talk about process issues and to talk vaguely about spending caps and preserving the PFD and things like that. You're going to have to me, candidates are going to have to get down into the details, down into the nitty gritty sum of how they're going to close that billion and a half dollar gap. And as I say, it's not just a 1 year gap. So you can't use, you know, you can't use the reverse sweep as your answer, because that's a 1 year answer and we got a 10-year problem. So it's the binding caucus is a problem. The process is a problem, but we need to talk about this. This campaign, I think, to me, needs to be about the substance of how you're going to close this gap.
Well, and I think maybe what we need, we need a candidate forum. You know, that's maybe what we need, is we need a good candidate forum with Brad Keithley as a moderator, asking some questions and showing some slides and asking them how they're going to deal with that. That would be an interesting conversation, to say the least. Maybe that's something we should work towards, Brad, to try and put together. That would be good. That would be eye opening, I think.
That's a good idea, Michael. That's something the show could do outside the That's something we could do outside the boundaries of the show. That's an interesting idea.
Yeah, I think we might want to talk about that. What are you going to be working on as you look at these candidates? What are the questions you're going to be asking them here in the next 2 minutes? If you can give me just kind of an idea of, you know, what direction are you going when you talk to candidates or pose these questions to candidates?
It's going to be, I mean, the first question is going to be open ended. What are you going to do about the $1.5 billion gap that we've got between the PFD and current spending levels? And if the answer to that is I'm going to cut spending, then let's talk about where you're going to cut spending and whether that's realistic. If the answer is I'm going to have use additional revenues, okay, where are the revenues going to come from, and how are you going to structure them? It's all going to be focused, for me at least, it's all going to be focused on that gap and what the plans are for dealing with the gap. I mean, the gap's not fictitious. The gap's there. And candidates need to have a plan, at least from my perspective. Candidates need to have a plan to address it. They just can't wish it away. And I'm not going to be tolerant, really, of candidates who say, well, I'm just going to, you know, do the reverse sweep or not do the reverse sweep. As I say, that will get you a year out of 10. And that's not going to be much of a solution. So it's all going to be about the gap and what candidates are going to do, what candidates' thoughts are with respect to closing that gap.
And I really like this idea of having a public forum. I think we need to do that. I think you and I should talk about that here off the air here in the near future. Maybe we should come together and have a candidates forum and get some of these, especially some of these more contentious seats, where the control is, and invite the, they may not show up, but we'll invite them, the Kathy Geisels and the Natasha von Imhoffs and the Bert Stedmans and the John Coghills of the world with their opponents, and ask them these questions. I think these are going to be very, very viable questions that need to be answered. That brings us to number two, which we got a couple minutes here to kind of tease and set the groundwork for. The Alaska LNG project has received some good news from the feds. Let's talk about those FERC approvals.
Well, we finally got the FERC approval, which is sort of the key federal approval. There are a lot of other federal approvals that the project needs as well, but they flow out of the FERC approval. The FERC approval is sort of the hub for those. And after a long and arduous process, the state finally has achieved the project finally achieved the approvals, the FERC approval necessary to go forward with the project. Now, that doesn't mean the project's anywhere near ready to go forward. Larry Persley had a decent piece in the ADN over the weekend, talking about the fact that the project isn't economic under current LNG circumstances, and I think that's exactly right. We've started tracking world LNG prices. The LNG market's become a lot more liquid, and the LNG prices are depressed. The AGDC, the Alaska Gas Line Development Corp, the state agency responsible for the project, and who's been on the lead on the project, and who's the holder of the FERC certificate, has talked about trying to find a partner. If it can't find a partner, putting the assets up for auction. Unlike some, I think there's going to be some buyers in an auction if the AGDC goes forward. But I think there are going to be many who are going to be surprised at who those buyers are and not happy with who those buyers are.
What are we talking about, Brad?
Well, Michael, there may be other bidders as well, but I think we're going to have two bidders for these assets. And again, what AGDC has talked about is getting to a point. They've gotten the FERC approvals. They're in the midst of a reassessment of the project cost, with a hope that the project cost comes down. The last estimate was a few years ago. It was $43 billion. They're hoping that the project cost comes down, perhaps significantly, perhaps below 40, into the 30s. And then a process where they try to see if there's any partners out there that want to go forward with the project currently. And then they've talked about a process that if they're not able to find anybody that wants to go forward with the project currently after they've reassessed the costs, then putting the assets that the state owns up for auction. And these are significant assets. They're not hard assets in terms of pipe, but the assets that would be up for bid are the permits, the approvals around the project. The state has about $500 million, about $500 million invested in those permits, expenditures they made to get to the point. And as we just were talking about in the break, those permits have positioned you to be able to go forward quickly if the economics of the project break and there's a path forward to making the project work. I think there's going to be two bidders. If the bidding is wide open, one's going to be China. I think China would, if they were permitted to buy the assets, I think there is a chance that China would go forward with the project. They would view it as a long-term resource that would be, if they bought the assets and built the pipe, that would be under their control in the Pacific Rim, in a location that's relatively accessible to Chinese markets, more accessible than in the U.S. Gulf Coast. There's been rumors about China going into the U.S. And picking up some of the distressed assets, some of the distressed shale assets that are out there, right, coming on the market as a result of current market conditions.
Right.
And I think it would make a lot of sense for China to give a very hard look at the Alaska LNG assets. The other potential bidder would be Russia. And why Russia? Because Alaska LNG is probably a fairly significant competitor to Russian LNG projects, and it would be, while they wouldn't articulate it this way, it would be one of those things where you buy out somebody to avoid them being a competitor. You would use terminology about, you know, consolidation and lower overhead and all that sort of stuff that you do when you're buying a competitor, but it would be to buy out a competitor. I think those are, if we go to auction, I think those are the two likeliest bidders in an auction, and I think they would make significant bids. At least China would make a significant bid. The question is whether we would ever accept that. But that's where these assets fit right now. They fit in either China's hands or they fit in Russia's hands.
And that's, of course, kind of a scary proposition. If Russia, China may buy it and develop it because they would be one of the largest consumers of this in this half of the world. But Russia buying it and then basically shelving it, I mean, really is kind of what they would do. They would sit on it, until their assets are expended, because, as you said, as a competitor, that would make sense for them not to compete with themselves, and we'd be back to where we were before.
So Alaskans may say, well, we got to sell these assets. I mean, we've got $500 million into them. We got to sell them. We got to maximize the value somehow. We want to put it in the hands of somebody who may take the project forward. Well, that's who you're going to be. If you want to maximize the value, by putting them into an open auction. That's who you're going to find are the most motivated bidders right now. So if that's not what you want, if you don't want it in their hands, then you need to temper your expectations of the prices we're going to get for these assets when they go to auction, because in anybody else's hands, I mean, the market for this stuff is China. So if you're not China, you're hoping you would buy these assets with the hope of someday using them to deliver them to China. If China is not your partner in this, or China is not on board with buying the assets, they're going to be stranded assets for an extended period. So the value of them to somebody else other than China or Russia, I think, is going to be somewhat limited.
Now, this is all, of course, at this point speculation, but it's an educated guess based on where you what you've done and you know your history in the oil and gas market and kind of looking at this. What kind of time frame would we be talking about in that, Brad, before they would decide?
Oh, I think AGDC has said they want to be in a position to make that decision by the end of the year. I mean, they're talking about having the new cost estimate wrapped up fairly promptly in June, I think, was the last estimate I saw. Then they would go back to the traditional partners, ConocoPhillips, BP, Exxon, or Hillcorp now, and say, are you prepared to go forward with this project at the revised estimate? Go through a process of those discussions. Perhaps there would be others who would want to participate in discussions about going forward right now. But I think the expectation is those discussions get wrapped up by the end of the year, and then they talk about going to auction.
Harold says, Alaska LNG isn't going anywhere for another two decades. Forget the gas line. The market isn't ready for Alaska gas. The problem is, and this is just my take, and you can comment on it, Brad, but the problem is that if we base the pre-planning of like gas lines and oil lines, you know, based on current market conditions, we're always betting on future market conditions when we do that, right? Because the process is so long. And so, I mean, it took 3 years to get this FERC thing approved. It's got a 20-year cycle on it. If we bet on today's prices as to where things are going, nothing would ever get built. We've got to, you know, look at where things are going to be in the future. Am I wrong?
No, you're right. But the problem is the projections of future prices aren't much better than aren't much better than current prices. The Platts has a futures market now for what's called JKM, Japan Korea marker crude, which is sort of the Asian marker crude, or Asian marker LNG rather. I'm sorry. And it goes out like 5 years. I think I was doing it over the weekend. And it never gets out of the $5 range. It's currently below even that, but it never gets out of the $5 range. So, yeah, we need to look forward, but the forward look isn't a whole lot better than the current look. Things may change, and you want to be positioned to go forward, and that's been the philosophy that AGDC's used to, you know, continue to spend the dollars. Along with partners, continue to spend the dollars to get the FERC approvals, because now you've got the FERC approvals and you don't have to wait around for them anymore. But the economics do need to change.
Harold thinks that we're all writing total fiction here at this point, and that we're just wasting our time talking about this because this is all fantasy.
Well, LNG is either going nowhere or it's going somewhere, and as I say, the AGDC has talked about putting the assets up for auction, so they're trying to push it somewhere. Where would the somewhere be? Well, it's not going to be in a U.S. supplier who doesn't have a market guaranteed in China. Who's got the market? China. So if they go somewhere, they're going to go to the market. They're going to go to China, or they're going to go to Russia, who wants to take down a competitor. It's not speculation. That's just what the market forces would tell you they're going to be. If we don't want it to go to China, and we don't want it to go to Russia, and we would exclude them as bidders, then the assets may not go anyplace. But if we want them to go someplace, if we want, you know, want to either recover our $500 million or want to push forward with the project, that's who the market participants would be.
That takes us on to number three. No, I'm really getting ambitious here. Number three, which is the discussion about the Alyeska lifting proration. And does that mean increased oil? We got about 3.5 minutes here.
Yeah, so we've seen a lot of headlines in the past few days. Alyeska made a big deal out of the fact that it had lifted proration on the system. Earlier in the month, it imposed a 50,000 barrel a day cut on what producers could put into the system in the aggregate, prorated it back. So each producer had a proportionate cut in the volumes that would otherwise tender. And Alyeska did that because the loading schedule out of Valdez, the market demand out of Valdez was softening, and Alyeska saw a potential situation where the volumes coming at it being delivered by the producers would overwhelm its storage. The offtakes wouldn't come rapid. The ships wouldn't come rapidly enough and overwhelm its storage, so it imposed a proration. Alyeska has made a big deal in the past few days of rolling that proration back, saying, well, we don't need to prorate the system anymore because we're back in balance and we don't have a concern about what's going to happen at storage. A lot of people, including some reporters, have taken that as good news that production's going to be back up and we're going to be, you know, all these concerns about reduced production are now in the rearview mirror and we're back up and rolling. That's not true. Part of what's going on is that Conoco has cut back production significantly, has slowed the amount of tenders it's making into the pipeline system. And Conoco's announced for June that it's cutting even deeper in June. It's cutting 100,000 barrels a day. The proration was 50,000 barrels a day in May, but Conoco's announced that it's cutting 100,000 barrels of production in June. So production on the system, throughput through Alyeska is actually dropping, has been dropping since Alyeska made the announcement, as opposed to going back up. I'm not doing anything other than I don't want people to have the sense of, oh, we've worked out of this. Yes, price is still a problem, but production isn't a problem anymore. Production's going to go back up. And so, you know, the production cavalry has somehow come over the hill to save us. That's just not the case. The production cavalry is still going down. Conoco's made the announcement of 100,000 in June, and they haven't limited it to just June. They haven't said it's going to extend beyond June. But they haven't limited it to just June. And there's some really bizarre stuff going on in the market right now. Conoco, in addition to the 100,000 cut, Conoco has a tanker headed for China, has a tanker headed for Asia. So there's not even with the 100,000 barrel a day cut, there's not enough demand on the U.S. West Coast right now, even to absorb that reduced level of production. They're sending some of their production off to China. So
right.
We're not out of this yet.
It's all about demand. It's all about where the markets are going. We need to get things reopened to help this thing kick started, but we're still looking at some bleak days ahead. Let's say, you know, hypothetically, you know, the demand recovers. You know, the states are all reopening right now. California may eventually. Now we're seeing legal challenges across the country in, I think, up to 9 states now are challenging some of these shutdowns and things like this. Let's say in the next 6 months, everything kind of comes back, stabilizes, the demand increases. Where do we go production-wise in your mind as you look at this? Do we go back to more normal levels, or are we at a permanently depressed rate on production for the foreseeable future?
No, I think we go back to the 500,000 barrels a day that we were producing before we went into this. I mean, if West Coast demand recovers, then that market will open back up and we'll take ANS barrels. It's going to take a while for the U.S. West Coast to recover. Not only are they going to be slower in opening up than other parts of the country. I mean, California, Washington, and Oregon are going to be slower in opening up. But they're also heavily jet fuel markets, and so the jet fuel component of the market is going to be slower in recovering than other areas. And the U.S. West Coast still has a bunch of ships, floating storage sitting offshore, waiting to unload. We've had two ANS tankers sitting in the Puget Sound for like the past 10 days, waiting to unload. There's a bunch of supply, excess supply that's sitting in tankers off the U.S. West Coast that still has to be worked through. So once the West Coast opens back up, demand opens back up, and we work off the surplus, I think we'll be back up to 500,000 barrels a day. But it's not going to be tomorrow. It's not going to be the day after that. I mean, Conoco's made clear that they're going to be in curtailment through June. And it may be into the fall, maybe deep into the fall, before we finally work off the surplus on the U.S. West Coast.
Brad Keithley, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. You can find a link on the Facebook page. Brad, thank you so much for coming on board.
Michael, as always, thanks for having me. Well, that's a wrap for another week's edition of the Weekly Top 3 from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you again for joining us. Remember that you can find past episodes on our YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify pages, and keep track of us during the week on Facebook and Twitter. This has been Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. We look forward to you joining us again next week on the Weekly Top 3.